Hello, everyone. Welcome to the show. Put your feet up while the world collapses around us. Blimey, where to even begin? One second. Let me just... That's myself speaking online. So, blimey, where do we even begin? To quote the well-known philosopher Phil Collins, it's just another day in paradise. Now, the government the last few days has become something sort of resembling a burning skip and the final scenes of a Quentin Tarantino film. In the latest episode of The Totally Normal Country in Which We Live, there's been this palace coup involving, amongst others, Allegra Stratton, the former political editor of Newsnight, because we have this revolving door in this country between broadcast media, which is supposed to kind of scrutinize the government, and the government itself. Now, amongst the casualties of this palace coup is, of course, Baron Cummings of Barnard Castle. Who knows how he's going to retrain, maybe as an optician or a driving instructor. And the other casualty, of course, is Lee Cain, a spin doctor who was once best known for dressing up as a chicken and running after politicians. There he is. Look at him. Bless his little chickeny face. Now, amongst their many transgressions, they're accused of briefing against Boris Johnson and his fiancée, who apparently they've called Princess Nutnuts. Now, we don't know how this is all going to pan out. Does it end with, in time, Boris Johnson terminally wounded, his government lurches from crisis to calamity, his ratings are in free fall, Tory MPs are openly briefing against him, and according to the Telegraph and other right-wing newspapers, he may even be gone in the next year. Now, I don't know. And this is where we're going to be kind of lighthearted with a lot of what we do in the show. But there is something we need to talk about, because politics in this country is often treated essentially as a soap opera. Who's up? Who's down? Who's in? Who's out? Who's marginalized? Who's influential? And the real material conditions that affect millions of people, often brutally so, across the country, those material conditions are often completely ignored when we talk about politics. So let's talk. Let's give an example of that. As we learned from Shakespearean comedy to Greek tragedy in Number 10, in the last week alone, 3,000 of our fellow citizens have died of coronavirus. In the last few weeks, in the last few months, tens of thousands of our fellow citizens have died in the course of this deadly pandemic, their deaths often as cruel and lonely as they were, in all too many cases, completely avoidable. And it is worth saying this, because each was a human life. Each loved and was loved, each mattered, and each and everyone deserved better. When my dad died, just to get a bit personal, but when my dad died 3 years ago, we were in a warm hospice, comfortable hospice room, as Bob Dylan and Bruce Springsteen and the band played, and his family, we could all hold his hands as he took his last breath. Not so for the tens of thousands who've died of coronavirus in the last few months, comforted often by artificial ventilators and overstressed, under-resourced and undervalued frontline staff of our National Health Service. These are the people who are often completely airbrushed when we talk about the ins and the outs of modern politics. Now, the fact that so many would die, it was inevitable. But the fact that we have the worst death toll in Europe and the fifth worst official death toll in the world, that wasn't inevitable. In the last few months, 50,000 of our fellow citizens have died. But if you look at excess deaths above the five-year average, that's what our own doctors, our own prime minister said was the most reliable metric. It's 72,000 people dead in the course of this pandemic. That's one in every 920. Now, if you go by our rulers, this is like an act of God. Of course, things could have been done differently. Of course, mistakes were made along the way. Of course, we do things, you know, with the benefit of hindsight, things could have been done differently. But it wasn't an act of God, as the Sunday Times revealed, for years of conservative austerity to lead to personal protective equipment being left to degrade and be rendered useless. It wasn't an act of God for scientists who pleaded for emergency masks and gowns, for their pleas to be ignored whilst they were exported to China. It wasn't an act of God that compelled our prime minister to skip the first Cobra meetings as COVID-19 lapped at the shores of this country. There was no decree from God which forced the government to refuse or to fail to implement the recommendations of a trial pandemic run in 2016 because they splashed all their resources on preparing for a no-deal Brexit. It wasn't a decree from on high that forced Boris Johnson to boast of shaking the hands of patients in a hospital overrun by coronavirus at the beginning of March, on the very day that Sage told people not to shake anybody's hands at all. No act of God ended with Cheltenham Festival issuing a statement saying that they were justifying their decision to go ahead because our Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, had attended an international rugby match. And nor did an act of God lead to the government responding to the scenes of Northern Italy being overrun by coronavirus and indeed by death by briefing sympathetic journalists that they would pursue a policy of herd immunity, allowing the virus to let rip in this country. And of course, that's exactly what it did. And no act of God led to lockdown being delayed until it was too late, with one study suggesting that if it was just 3 days earlier, 20,000 people, their lives could have been saved and they could still be amongst us today. No decree from on high compelled this government to drive vulnerable patients to discharge them from hospitals, put them into care homes, and seed the virus in the most vulnerable sector of them all, allowing it to let rip like a firestorm, which is exactly what it did. And neither did some Holy Spirit compel the government to hand test and trace to scandal-ridden private contractor cronies who made an absolute disastrous mess of one of the most important tasks of all in the course of this pandemic. And no higher power forced the government to reopen society and the economy without a functioning test and trace system, to drive people back to the office with the threat of being sacked if they refuse to do so, splashed on the front of the Telegraph, to eat out, to help out, to have a patriotic duty and have a pint down the pub, to reopen schools, to reopen universities, so over a million students crisscross from every corner of the country to every other corner of the country. The consequences of this are as predictable as they were predicted at the time. And again, finally, no act of God compelled the government to ignore Sage on the 21st of September when they told the government to do a short circuit breaker lockdown to bring infections down to a manageable level and instead allow the infections to run riot and lead to a situation where we have a long and harsh lockdown that could have been avoided. So I suppose to return to the question, will Boris Johnson survive? Who's up? Who's down? These are things we do need to talk about. Of course we do. But all too often, the realities of government policy are completely ignored or marginalized or excuses made for them. And during this, the worst crisis since World War II, there is less of an excuse for that than there has ever been. Now, he may well survive with the help of a supine media, but there is one certainty that on Monday, hundreds will die, and on Tuesday, and on Wednesday, and on Thursday, and on Friday. And in all too many cases, those deaths were avoidable because of political choices that were made by those who rule us, who turned an unavoidable disaster into a needless national calamity. And again, to finish up where we began, each was a human life, each loved and loved, each mattered, and each deserved better. Right, on that somber opening, we can now relax, and I can bring in two absolutely incredible guests. The first is Peter Oborne. What a huge honour to have Peter here. Now, I'm gonna make his ears ring with the praise I'm about to bombard him with. Peter is someone not from my political tradition. He's from a right of centre tradition. He was the chief political commentator at the Daily Telegraph. And he resigned because the Daily Telegraph refused to cover a scandal involving the bank HSBC because they were receiving advertising money from it. Very few journalists would have done that. The amount of integrity it took to do that in a industry which is very punishing of those who dissent is phenomenal. And there were other reasons, many reasons, to praise him. One, amongst all too few commentators on left or right, he's always taken an uncompromising stance against Islamophobia, which is rampant and passes the middle-class dinner party test in this country, but also takes on, and this really boils the, I'm just going to say, the piss of so many of the commentariat and political journalists in this country, because he takes on so-called client journalism, the relationship between, the close relationship between senior journalists and the government. So, Peter, a massive welcome.
Thank you, Erin. It's a great pleasure to be on your show.
It's an absolute honour that you were at the very beginning as well. And what a mix, what a combination we got, because, of course, now we've got the phenomenal Ash Sarkar. Come on in, Ash. Make yourself at home.
I'm afraid I don't have Peter's fabled integrity. I just haven't had the opportunity to sell out yet. I'm waiting.
Well, Ash, I mean, Ash, you are, I mean, one, a phenomenal journalist and writer, but I'm now going to do a couple of things to embarrass you as well. Oh. The first is, we've gone through a lot of traumas together, haven't we, Ash, I would say, in the past few years. We've looked after each other.
And of course, those traumas were mutually inflicted. I don't know what you're talking about. But...
or inflicted just by me. Who can forget election night, just minutes after the exit poll? Should we just flick up? There we are. Now, you can see there, this is literally general election night. You can see all hope and optimism disappearing from me. That's the moment my soul died. There it is. But on happier note, the most unlikely friendship in the British media has been formed between Ash and Nigella Lawson, the National Institution. Let's just start by putting that on.
The latest addition to my repertoire came from a tweet I saw by the political journalist Ash Sarkar, and she mentioned a recipe that came from her home, and she described it as nostalgia in a dish and the equivalent of a tea-dipped madeleine to Proust. And what really captivated me was that every ingredient was familiar, the method was familiar, and yet what it created was entirely new to me, and it spoke of real lives and real food, and I really raced, as much as I can ever race, into the kitchen to cook it, and I haven't stopped.
I mean, you peaked. Where else is there for you to go, Ash?
Nowhere. I'm genuinely going to lay down and die shortly after this podcast, because my life's just going to be a journey downhill.
The approval of Nigella Lawson must be protected at all costs. Right, let's get straight.
She once wrote a column about me. Something I... but it's 25 years. I wrote a column about having dinner with somebody you probably disapprove of, Erin. And actually, I think
you need to say who that is now, Peter. Who was it?
Bruce Anderson, the Epicurean conservative columnist. And he I took him to dinner, and I wrote a restaurant review about watching him having dinner. And his sheer gluttony. I watched him eat some grouse, and the grouse came along, and he said, I want it rare, please. And he started to eat it, and it was so rare, it actually spurted blood. I recorded this, and then Bruce ate this grouse, and then he said, a little bit overdone, but otherwise it's okay.
So I'm not going to body shame, because I'm not a little guy. Yeah. But if you now, anyone who doesn't know who this is, Google them and their image, and you won't be surprised. It is an instantly entirely realistic scenario, which Peter has very eloquently described. Bruce, what a hero, what a character. So let's kick off. Cummings is gone. Now, what I'm going to talk to you about, Peter, to kick off, you wrote this pretty a corker of an article for Open Democracy last year. Should we just flash it up on the screen to give people the gist? So it was the title was British Journalists Have Become Part of Johnson's Fake News Machine. It's chilling. From the Times, the Mail, to the BBC and ITN, everyone is peddling Downing Street's lies and smears. They're turning their readers into dupes. Explain a kind of précis of the article, and then maybe we could kind of segue it into the fall of Dominic Cummings?
Yeah, everything changed about British government, and I think actually the Johnson administration, when he almost immediately on winning power, he hired Cummings, and Cummings, who is a grotesque figure, really, and I think will be, and has no sense of ordinary morality and hatred of decency, as far as I could see. But he brought with him a crowd of very undistinguished ninth-rate individuals into Downing Street. And Cummings and these creatures, some of whom have now left, and the rest I hope will go very soon, created a regime of news management which was based on actual deception. And it was horrible to watch the way, for instance, perfectly respectable public figures and cabinet ministers, for instance, were just smeared by Downing Street, by number 10 sources. Dominic Grieve was one. He was accused of being a traitor acting in concert with foreign powers. That's Dominic Grieve, the former Attorney General, a man of enormous distinction. There's another smear campaign issued against the former Chancellor of the Exchequer, Philip Hammond. And invariably it said number 10 sources. And so the obliging political journalist would say that according to number 10 sources, we learn that Dominic Grieve and other people as well of great distinction have been concerting with foreign powers, that they've been leaking things. It was all fabrication. And I looked into it and I proved that it was fabrication. And the trouble was that the mainstream media, political editors in the newspapers, political editors in the broadcast media were swallowing this rubbish from Cummings. And, well, you never knew exactly who it was, it said Cummings, but actually you could tell that it was Cummings and his ghastly creatures he brought with him in number 10, and passing them on uninspected. Effectively, they were becoming propagandists on behalf of these horrible people, I think, actually, who had infested number 10, having been brought in by Johnson. And it was an abuse of the role of destroy British public discourse, British culture. We are a decent country, I think. And it was very upsetting to see such senior figures, the media as a whole, lapping up this nonsense, which was coming from, on behalf of Johnson, from Cummings and his creatures. Lee Cain has gone and Cummings has gone, and I hope that some more will go. But the damage which has been done to British public life in the interim is colossal.
Before I bring Ash in, what I'm interested in, Peter, is what makes Cummings tick? Because he's someone who, he's not a member of the Tory party by all
accounts. Yeah.
I mean, he did this big speech about, which I'm sure a lot of people watching would actually have a lot of sympathy in, where he said that the Tories, you know, senior Tory MPs had contempt for the poor, for the NHS and so on. But what was he after? Because one of his allies in the Daily Telegraph today and the Sunday Telegraph was talking about how now we'll get this backsliding back towards basically this Cameroon liberal conservatism, that what Cummings was about was trying to tap into, as he put it, provincial working class Toryism, reinvent it. Was that how he saw it, regardless of the reality? And has that happened as he sees it? Or is Boris Johnson now going to readjust almost a kind of patrician, liberal, socially liberal, David Cameron type figure that Cummings lot hates?
Well, there's two questions you asked me there. One is whether or not Cummings succeeded in sort of rescuing some sort of Disraeli working class idea of working class conservatism, and whether he moved towards that. And secondly, whether Johnson is now going to revert to something else. Now, if you look at the handling, you dwelt on coronavirus. I mean, I think the Tories' so-called red wall and the contempt, really, for the a lot of Northern voters during that during the coronavirus handling, and it suggests that the Tories have lost that. You've seen the quite a healthy political development, I think, the revolt of the emergence of local politicians in the north. Of that's really exciting, but it's not a Tory thing; it's an anti-Tory thing. So I don't see here that he's achieved. I think they're destroying that so-called red wall thing. That will go back to Labour, I would imagine, most of those northern constituencies. What he has got is and in some ways justified, I quite sympathise with some of it, a contempt for liberal media. It's a weird example of it today, you know, and liberal institutions. Basically, it's maligned, this contempt for liberal institutions. You've got one of the Sunday papers, one of the right-wing papers today, had a story about SOAS, that glorious institution in central London, which specializes in Oriental languages. And, you know, apparently no white working class child went there or young person went there this year. So that's a sort of piece. It's the politics of resentment, which Cummings continues to do. He's used government to launch a series of culture wars against liberal academics, liberal institutions. For instance, I mean, an awful, horrible, I mean, a kind of disconcerting example is the appointment of David Goodhart to the Equalities and Human Rights Commission over the weekend. I mean, he's somebody who actually, did he praise the hostile environment regime?
Yes, very strongly so.
And what they do is they're trying to, and this is a constant attempt to, in stark culture wars, make immigrants very uncomfortable and give some sort of very primitive and barbarous form of white supremacism. And too many senior it's always set out in language which just falls short of doing that, but they're sending a huge number of messages out there that really, that unless you're a white person, preferably a right-wing one, you're not somehow part of the new setup under Cummings Britain. Now the paradox is that Boris Johnson isn't really, well, Johnson I knew him quite well, wasn't like that. He was a liberal internationalist when I knew him, but he's been captured by this, well, these very sinister figures, I feel, in the new vote leave machine, and they took over Downing Street and they inflicted the most enormous amount of damage. The next question is, will Boris Johnson flip back now to a liberal Cameronism? It's quite an interesting question, that, because Johnson, I think, is a political vacuum. And that, as I say, Johnson, who existed 20 years ago, was quite he was really a liberal. And I think he hitched onto the vote leave machine with its implicit racism. In a very successful bid to become prime minister, and now if Cummings and Co. go, that he might revert to something more like the normal political settlement. I don't think though that Johnson can survive without John Cummings for very long. However, because he had the opportunity on several occasions to ditch Cummings. Most crucially during the Barnard Castle affair, and that would have been a proper moment to have done so when he broke lockdown rules, which he was insisting should be enforced on everybody else. And now, according to the papers, I mean, I don't know if I believe much of them, and it's wretched, and it makes you feel ashamed to have anything to do with these people. But apparently it's because the fiancé of the Prime Minister has taken against Cummings, and therefore he's got to go. Well, look,
they called her Princess Nutnuts, apparently.
Yeah, I don't know what that's all about, but I mean, there's a grave. He completely destroyed the integrity of British government at that moment, and the national consensus about fighting COVID. And now apparently he's fallen out with the Prime Minister's fiance, and that is the way he's gone. And now it's such a frivolous thing. It's a shaming awfulness about that.
I mean, Ash, what do you think in terms of the Cummings project? Do you think it is an existential threat? He's out. to Boris Johnson. And also that point about culture war. I mean, take as an example, Manura Mirza. She's the director of the policy unit. And she's from what can only be described as the most successful Trotskyist organization in Britain, the Revolutionary Communist Party, who were a very idiosyncratic revolutionary group in the 80s and the 90s, who reinvented themselves as a very bizarre right-wing libertarian group called Spiked. And they're everywhere. You know, they're at the Spectator. They're enshrined in, they're ensconced in the Boris Johnson machine. And she's quite keen on culture war stuff, apparently. So do you think, you know, how much of a blow is Cummings going? But also, where does it leave the culture war approach?
Well, let me treat these two questions separately. First, let's address the question of Cummings. I do think that there's a problem that both Cummings's fiercest detractors and supporters tend to play into a kind of great man of history theory. They think that everything that's bad in the Conservative government or the politics of Brexit is due to him, or everything that's been, successful, you know, the Conservative Party is a ruthless campaigning machine, is also down to him. And so I think we've got to look at what he's been good at through the eyes of a Conservative, and also what he's failed to do. He very cannily and astutely identified those weaknesses in the Labour electoral coalition, which had been in steady decline really since 2001 and accelerated its demise after 2017. He was really, really good at doing that. Another thing that he was able and adept at doing, and it's, I think, because of, you know, the British media really is just a, you know, King Charles Spaniel waiting to have many tickled, is creating an information universe, which one contributed to the utter degradation of the public sphere, this idea you can't really trust anything that you're reading, which is useful if you're governing, and two, meant that you had high-profile journalists who are essentially propagandists for the government. And I think in terms of some of the highest-profile journalists, the willingness of, say, you know, Robert Peston and Laura Koonsberg to put out information which is completely untrue, verifiably false, you know, the lurid story during the general election of a Corbynite campaigner punching Matt Hancock's aide outside of a hospital, which was completely discredited, for me, is a particularly egregious example. I don't know if these are sins of idiocy or malevolence, or simply just not taking the integrity of the journalistic profession particularly seriously. You want to be successful, you're successful through access, you'll do anything to retain access to people who are powerful. I don't know. I don't know which it is. So he's been effective at those things. But the big promise of Cummings was that he was going to bend the civil service to his will. He was going to completely transform the business of governance in the UK. He certainly did instill something of a reign of terror amongst special advisors, having Sonia Khan frog marched out of Westminster by armed police being a particularly egregious example of that. But he, like many others who have set out to ruthlessly apply the principles of their favoured area of business to the civil service, didn't really succeed. For Dominic Cummings, in a kind of, you know, faddish way, he was like, I'm going to apply the principles of Silicon Valley to the business of government. You know, one part Peter Thiel, two parts Mark Zuckerberg. Didn't actually work out that way. He turned out to be much more skilled at campaigning than he was at governing, which, you know, compared to Boris Johnson, that, you know, it's really quite remarkable. Boris Johnson is the only person on the planet who's even worse at governing. So I think that that's the thing, is that you've got to assess Cummings's strengths and limitations in terms of what he did for Boris Johnson and what he did for the Conservatives more generally. Second thing is about culture wars. There are lots of people amongst the lobby who think that with Cummings and Lee Cain gone, that's the end of the culture wars. I don't believe that's true. As you said, Munira Mirza, who is, I think, director of policy, she comes from that Spiked background. She was touted as a head of an inquiry into institutional racism, which would have been, I think, maybe our fifth or sixth such inquiry in 5 years. And she's someone who doesn't really believe institutional racism exists. So it'd be like appointing a climate change denier into a study of renewable energy or something, right? Just completely outrageous. You've also got figures at the heart of government like Kemi Badenoch. I don't know if that's how you pronounce the last syllable of her surname. Is it Badenoch or Badenoch?
I think you're right. Badenoch.
Badenoch. This is the really embarrassing thing where you say a word out loud that you've only ever read and you're like, oh God, this is awful. And you've also got Priti Patel. And all three of these figures, Munira Mirza, Kemi Badenoch and Priti Patel, they've got instincts, I think, very keen instincts on how to play the culture wars. They've got, I think, in particular, Priti Patel, a very authoritarian, nationalistic instincts. And they also play an important role. And this is what one journalist called Musa Okwonga described as the racial gatekeeper. And the racial gatekeeper is a person of color who gives permission for not just racist policies, but also racist viewpoints. And Priti Patel lent into that in her Conservative Party conference speech this year. It was saying, the left hates me because I don't live up to their expectations of what an Indian woman should be like. So it is appropriating some of the language of anti-racism and using it for a deeply reactionary goals. And I think because there has been a kind of decoupling of anti-racism, I think, from projects of collective transformation. There's a kind of liberal identity politics where anti-racism is just whatever you happen to feel as a person of color. There are, I think, people even amongst liberal circles who've got a lot of time for that. They see that the left's criticism of Priti Patel on anti-racist lines is a kind of ideological policing rather than any kind of principled opposition. And I think with those kinds of figures still in government, I don't see culture wars going away, not least because intensely polarized ideas around race, culture, the nation, and belonging was part of what drove that fragmentation of the Labour electoral coalition. So I don't think that that goes away just because Cummings does. I think perhaps what is more at risk is this idea of, you know, big statist interventionist spending. Rishi Sunak's instincts were always a bit more of, you know, kind of a deficit hawk. I wonder if he will have a bit more of a free rein to act upon that with Cummings gone. I'm not sure. But that's as far as my conservative Kremlinology extends. I did my best. I mean, I've never met these people.
Before we talk about Rishi Sunak, in terms of Boris Johnson, I mean, Tory MPs are known to be ruthless. Margaret Thatcher, 1990, she'd led the Tories to three victories, two epic landslides. She'd crushed the social democratic settlement. She'd crushed the trade union movement. And yet in 1990, Tory MPs decided, it doesn't matter what you've done. We're very grateful. You're out. And with Boris Johnson, it seems ludicrous in a sense. It's less than a year since he brought the Tories to their first working majority for over three decades. The idea he would in any way be in danger in the abstract seems absurd. But what I'm wondering about is that ruthlessness? Do you think, is that the threat that faces him, that at some point they'll decide he's no longer an asset, he's a liability? And is it the case? I remember thinking back to 2018, I don't hang out with Tory MPs very often, but in a green room before we went on some TV show, where Tory MP promised me, he said, there's no way that Boris Johnson's getting in the last two of the parliamentary ballot to determine who gets the two candidates to get on the ballot paper, because Tory MPs had so much contempt for him, and that only changed in 2019 because they thought he was this unique antidote to Corbynism and to Farageism. He was the one populist politician the Tories could rely on to slay both those beasts. So what do you think? I mean, what do they really think of him, Tory MPs? And do you think now they think he may well have outlived his use and they'll do what they did to Thatcher?
Well, yeah. It's hard to tell. I wasn't sure he was going.
Pete, you go for it, and then we'll bring you in, Ash. Your pills of wisdom are still.
I think, well, the thing we haven't mentioned, there's two things we haven't mentioned, by the way, just slightly to avoid, which I think we should mention in this context of Cummings. One is there a substantial reason he's left? Is that something to do with the deal in Europe? I mean, that's what I imagine is happening, that there's a disagreement about the nature of the deal, whether there should be a deal, and it's a massive existential moment for the nation's economy. And the second thing, of course, is Biden. In some ways, Cummings is Steve Bannon, and this outrageous advisor to the leader. And he didn't stay very long. And for Cummings to go just days after the replacement of the defeat, the magnificent, cheerful making defeat of this barbaric president, of whom Boris Johnson is the English country cousin, slightly more genteel and doesn't like quite as much, but it's the same theme. I just don't think it's that much of a coincidence. I think that there's a new kind of politics coming across the world, and it's sweeping very, it's made equally unpleasant for Mohammed bin Salman in Saudi Arabia, the Crown Prince, Benjamin Netanyahu in Israel, the Sisi in Egypt. And I think Johnson is another one, this right-wing populism. It doesn't feel so good anymore. Biden is going to lead to a rise in standards across the globe, and part of that rise in standards, the removal of Johnson's Steve Bannon. But the matter of the Conservative Party, it's quite sad. Most Tory MPs I talk to, I don't want to present myself as an expert. Really did believe in Johnson, and like the press, brought him into office. And so they've got to, it's a massive mea culpa if they're going to dislodge him. My view is they will. I don't think Johnson is capable of being prime minister. It's blindingly obvious to people who study politics and know about it, including quite a few Tory MPs, that this He can't do the job. He hasn't the attention to detail or the sense of duty or the sense of propriety or the patriotism which you'd need. The basic, and they kind of in a national leader, you need somebody who can forget about their own ego. He's a narcissist like Trump. Both men thought that politics was about them, not about serving the nation. And I think that will mean. I don't rule out a direct move to Keir Starmer, by the way, because I think we have to understand the gravity of this current situation. We're in a very terrifying moment, a phony war, if you like, or in those Bugs Bunny cartoons, is it the rabbit who goes over the cliff and his little legs wave around, and then he plunges to earth. There's probably the structural unemployment now in this country. I mean, so many people are going to lose their jobs. The national finances, which I'm afraid I take a conservative view of, I think, are a terrible mess. And they are going to, it's going to lead to terrible cuts in due course. Next year is a chilling year and a really chilling year. The worst year, we've got to go back to the 1930s. And I don't believe that Johnson has the capacity to lead us through a crisis of that nature. Actually, very few politicians do. I don't think that the Chancellor of the Exchequer has the stature to do that. Jeremy Hunt is the only plausible Conservative leader, the one who stood against Johnson and came second and ought to have won, probably, if the Conservative Party hadn't been captured by the Vote Leave kind of mania. So, but it is in practice, it has to be the Conservative Party. Johnson, more than 40 MPs have to move against him. And that does happen in Conservative majorities. You know, that Chamberlain had a massive majority in 40. That then Thatcher had a colossal majority in 1990 and had to go. Difficult for the Conservatives to do this flip again, because they did it with Cameron left midterm. It's very anti-democratic. May left midterm. And if Johnson, they do it again with Johnson, I don't think that it might work. I think there's a very likely, there is a serious likelihood of a historic realignment of politics and Prime Minister Starmer well before the next election. As for Johnson, he's on borrowed time.
Ash, what were you going to say? Because I rudely interjected. I'm sorry about that. But also, bear in mind what Peter said. But also, do you think no-deal Brexit is now dead, both because of Biden and because of Cummings out? What do you think?
Well, I think a no-deal Brexit is made much harder by Biden being in the White House. I don't think that Boris Johnson can expect such a, you know, close, simpatico relationship with the White House team. There's going to be an awful lot of pressure from Biden for there to be a trade deal between the UK and the EU. And, you know, America might be a declining empire, but it is still an empire. It's an awful lot of geo-economic power there. And I think that ultimately there will be some kind of a trade agreement. I think as
well, by the way, it's got to be a specific trade agreement. What Biden has said to Johnson, obviously, is you are not going to break the Good Friday Agreement, i.e. the border. Remember, Mr. Johnson, one of the many lies from Mr. Johnson involved the withdrawal agreement. We've got to have the border is now going to be, I assume, unless Britain wants to become an international pariah in the age of Biden, the border's got to be at the North Sea. It can't be north and south. And it mustn't be for all kinds of moral reasons. We entered into an obligation at the time of the Good Friday Agreement negotiated superbly, it should be said, by Tony Blair. And
I mean, I think on this matter of what the agreement in Northern Ireland is going to look like, I don't think it's going to be all that different from the protocol established in the withdrawal agreement.
That's a humiliating retreat from Johnson. That is why it's rather annoyed me, actually. I haven't read very much, and mercifully I've been abroad where people in Armenia and Nagorno-Karabakh, where you do realise that we are, how fortunate we are in this country. Although we seem set on destroying our own political stability, but I do think that we have to abide by these international obligations which we committed ourselves to so long ago. And if we start tearing those up, and that's what Johnson wanted to do, that's what this wretched creature David Frost, our negotiator and so-called national security advisor, wants to do. And I think that isn't going to be possible for Britain to do that in the age of Biden. The punishment from Europe and from the United States. So let's forget all this gossip which we're getting out of Downing Street by these 21st, I mean, these wretched ninth-rate creatures who should never have been there in the first place, bitching about each other. Let's discuss the great issues that are at stake. And I'm assuming that one of those great issues, there are two actually, because COVID is the other, but Brexit at the moment, which is absolutely imminent. That is, there is an argument between Cummings, who's a nihilist who wants to destroy and doesn't care if we don't get an agreement, doesn't care if violence resumes in Northern Ireland, because he wants to create maximum mayhem. And that there are people still, I'm assuming, who do recognise that it would be grossly irresponsible and a terrible betrayal of everything Britain stands for and our obligations to the Irish people and the obligations to ordinary British working class folk who want to keep their jobs, etc., etc. And I assume there is somebody in Downing Street saying we must do a deal which recognises the Good Friday Agreement. Now, and that is why Dominic Cummings finally has walked out, I'm guessing. Because I assume I'm hoping and praying that the grown-ups are taking charge, and this, of course, coincides at the moment that President Biden has emerged on the scene to create a new pattern of decency in international politics. I mean, for instance, Sisi in Egypt over the weekend has suddenly started to release political prisoners. You know, there's suddenly the world's getting a better place because we've got Biden, and in just as Sisi is feeling the wind up his sails, so he's going to start to behave a little bit more decently. You get MBS in Saudi Arabia, will get find that the real punishments when people get murdered by his regime. Likewise, I think Boris Johnson is suddenly waking up to a new world which he didn't care about.
Yeah, I mean on that, Ash. I mean, we need to remember that the last Tory prime ministers were killed by the issue of Europe. I mean, John Major was, of course, David Cameron was, Theresa May was. in the end, do you think this is what's going to destroy Boris Johnson? Not the pandemic, unfortunately, not the avoidable deaths of so many people in this country and the biggest death toll in Europe and the economic consequences, but the fact now that many of those who supported Boris Johnson, whipped up by his rhetoric, they expect the so-called clean break Brexit. And when they end up, you know, because there's a myth about the deal that was struck last year, actually what happened was it wasn't the EU that blinked. Boris Johnson just changed the terms of the agreement by saying you know, the one thing Theresa May said no British Prime Minister could ever agree to, which is essentially, you know, the Conservative and Unionist Party to violate the territorial integrity of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. But do you think actually, Ash, that this is what's going to end up destroying Boris Johnson, the fact he won't be able to deliver what the big, hard, head-banging Brexiteers want?
Well, I think that in order to answer this question, I'm going to cheat and I'm going to pose another question. Oh, and the question that I'm going to pose
is... when people do that.
I know. But I am going to loop around. I promise I'm going to loop around. And for me, the question is, to what extent are the normal rules of what we think constitutes being good at politics, how true are they anymore? We thought that Trump was perhaps a... you know, irreversible break in those norms, that there was perhaps no going back for America. Of course, with a Biden victory, with a historic popular vote, that reading is troubled. And I think it's almost an accelerationist tendency within the left to look at things purely in terms of, you know, secular and not cyclical crisis. There's no going back. This is a chasm which has opened up between now and the past. So things like U-turns were once, you know, deaths, you know, by a thousand cuts for a prime minister, would make them look weak, unprincipled, lack of a central vision. Some people would say, well, Boris Johnson has already significantly undermined those norms, and that's not necessarily been an issue for him. Tory party still stubbornly refusing to fall below 40%, even though Brexit is a mess, and we have waltzed into a second lockdown, which was entirely preventable had we used the time wisely that we bought with the first one. The thing that I would say, again, warning of that, is that, well, Biden showed that there was an appetite amongst the electorate for a restoration of a much more technocratic form of government. One of the things that Barack Obama said in the election campaign was, with Kamala Harris and Joe Biden in the White House, you won't have to think about them very much. With Boris Johnson, without Cummings' media manipulation, all of these U-turns, whether it's on Brexit and trashing the deal that he negotiated, or whether it's on free school meals, or whether it's about going into lockdown, without that kind of competent media management from Cummings, I don't think there will magically be a better sense of direction and strategic vision in number 10 with Cummings and Cain gone. Is will he be able to weather the political consequences of those U-turns? And how much will a Brexit U-turn matter? Because I hear what you're saying, which is that, you know, there are a lot of people, particularly in his party membership and also his backbenchers, who want a so-called clean break Brexit. What still I'm not sure about is to what extent the Brexit voters really care about the form of Brexit. Is it still very much a binary? And we're out now. Matters of what kind of trade agreement we get with the EU are neither here nor there. I think that really the kind of Brexit we get only really matters as much as, you know, number 10 wants or needs it to. I don't think that it's something which is going to motivate huge chunks of the Conservative electorate and fundamentally turn them against Johnson.
I mean, Pete, the point you made about Peter, about Rishi Sunak, because you didn't seem that impressed by Rishi Sunak, and he did appear out of nowhere, essentially because his predecessor, Sajid Javid, was removed, partly because he refused to sacrifice his independence to the Dominic Cummings machine, funnily enough. And, you know, I suppose Sajid Javid Sajid Javid was removed and then was replaced all of a sudden by this new chapter of the Exchequer that very few people knew about, except they associated him with the goodies that all Western governments had to dispense to stop the economy from collapsing. So that was all people knew about him. It was the self-employment scheme. It was the furlough scheme. It was eat out to help out, which was probably quite disastrous in hindsight. Well, in foresight, as many people predicted. But senior Labour figures, their argument about so-called Dishy Rishi, as he became known during eat out to help out, is that actually he's a different challenge to Labour, because Boris Johnson, according to their focus groups and the focus groups of the Tories and Labour alike, does seem to have some resonance and connection in certain so-called red wall seats that Rishi Sunak doesn't have. And actually, he would be a challenge in seats Labour won, like Putney and Canterbury, but they'd be able to win back some of the lost seats in the North and the Midlands. I don't know what you think about that. And do you know, I mean, who is Rishi Sunak? Is he, you know, is he was a Brexiteer, but is he more of a socially liberal but pro-austerity type Cameroon than Boris Johnson?
He looks it, doesn't he? He looks a bit like Macron, you know, sort of a technocrat. He was quite a talented city trader. And I do think it's an advantage he brings to modern politics. He's so rich, mainly through his wife, actually, that he's not going to be kind of gulled into taking 100,000 from some grubby lobbying firm like so many of his unfortunate former colleagues. But he's quite clearly quite intelligent. He's got a certain amount of personality. But I think he's too associated with this regime. How old is he? 40? I don't think he's got the weight. And also, I do think the way you're framing your question is old-fashioned, Owen. I think that the question is, you're saying everything, you're presenting everything in terms of tactics and positioning in the way in which politics has been played disastrously, actually, in the last 20 years, which led to the catastrophes, the political catastrophes we're now going through. We are facing a period of national... It's inevitable, and it's not only because of Brexit at all. I think we're going to have a period of national disaster, economic and in other ways, with the potential independence of Scotland. It's going to be a very, very profound moment in British history. And does Sunak have the... whether or not he appeals more to northern seats or southern seats, or whether he's more of an austerity merchant or a modernised, that's the sort of question we people would discuss endlessly, too much actually, ten years ago. I think the question is, there's going to be a call. What we are seeing is the death of a long period of modern politics. And you can trace it back where you want to, maybe to Blair's modernization or to Cameron's sort of aloof cynicism, whatever it is. But this is, the politics has always been played, about tactically. Now suddenly we're going to go back to the way we used to play it. What's the right thing to do? Who can make the really courageous decisions, not just a convenient decision which is then dressed up by spin doctors as courageous? You're going to have a national leader on a scale of a kind that we haven't had. Well, we can always pardon a Thatcher, an Attlee, Churchill, you know, that we have had such, Lloyd George. All parties have provided such figures, and we are going to have Britain at some point is going to have to come together with a national leader. I think the party system is smashed, and I do keep on saying, I don't think that the political class gets it. The media class certainly doesn't. Look 6 months ahead, and the nature, it's not, and and look at the real issues, which aren't political anymore. They're now economic and about identity and about nation. And we're going to, at some stage, we're going to have a truly serious politician. But Boris Johnson, among many things that can be said about him, was just a manifestation of deep irresponsibility by a generation of voters and politicians and media figures who just didn't understand that life can get serious, and it's got serious. And that's why Johnson can't survive, and that's why I don't see any evidence that Sunak's capable of emerging at this stage in his career. He may become more substantial as life goes on. That is why the one figure I think has got an amazing political opportunity now, not as a political opportunity, an opportunity to become a statesman, is a figure I don't actually greatly admire at the moment, and I think he's been quite cowardly on a lot of issues. I've written this, is Keir Starmer. And he has an opportunity because the Conservative Party is broke.
I mean, on that, let's be a bit more structural. I like this. A bit of good admonishing from Peter about reducing this too much to personality. So that's very, very important. So Peter's absolutely right. We're going to go through this astonishing level, this moment of upheaval.
Since the 1930s.
Since the 1930s, we're talking mass unemployment. We've already gone through the longest squeeze in living standards, let's not forget, since the Napoleonic War. And that one statistic, you can't understand everything from Brexit.
Well, you wait for the next 5 years, you get real collapse in living standards.
I mean,
so
look,
what are the political consequences of that going to be, Ash? Bearing in mind that Labour, as things stand, it's up for grabs, perhaps, or some are more cynical than others, isn't necessarily going to offer that transformative agenda. So where's that pent-up anger and frustration going to be? Can Starmerism accommodate that? Or is it going to end up that the social forces that are going to be unleashed by this period of turmoil, are they going to go elsewhere?
I mean, look, so I'm going to start with Keir Starmer, and then I do want to sort of add to Peter's analysis of some of these deeper structural issues. The key for Keir Starmer is whether or not he's going to be able to effectively capitalise on a deeply wearied and cynical electorate. It's not going to be necessarily on the politics of hope or a promise that this government will radically change your lives for the better. And I think that's particularly the case for young people. I think that young people, and I'm not just talking about a generation that's defined by social values, I'm talking about the way in which class composition plays out generationally. You know, the proportion of wealth controlled by millennials is, you know, in dire straits when you compare to the same age groups, you know, decades ago. Is that I really do feel that my generation and the generation below do not have effective political representation in either Keir Starmer's Labour Party and certainly not in the Conservative Party. I think there was a brief window with Jeremy Corbyn's leadership for all of its limitations and all of its strategic errors, where that was the case. But I don't necessarily see Keir Starmer coming through with a programme that can talk to those needs. So I think that it will be the same way that Biden was able to go, look, you're not going to have to think about me very much. Is that will Keir Starmer be able to sort of sell technocracy and managerialism as a good in itself? As a kind of relief and, you know, succor for a wearied electorate. But I want to add to Peter's analysis of these structural issues. Some of them are obviously caused by just the absolute shock of the pandemic, because something's happening for the first time in history, which is across the world, economies shutting down, as a public health response. And it's not really something that's happened ever before. You know, you've got an unemployment crisis, which is already beginning to bite. And you can see the way in which that's distributed across age as well, with young people who already had, you know, the least being affected the most. But I also think that there's a longer story here. And I think it's a 40-year story. And I think part of that 40-year story is really about the ongoing success of Thatcherism, because I think what Margaret Thatcher was able to do was successfully decouple how we perceive ourselves as political beings and our political identities and class identity, really, from the economic base. So you have a really absurd situation now, and you see this in some of the reporting, you know, even I think that came out from The Guardian, which was interviewing, you know, property developers and business owners in the Red One going, oh, well, you're working class because you've got a regional accent and you know, your politics on certain issues, you know, are more right wing and more reactionary. There you go. You've got an absurd situation where I think it was one journalist whose name I forget was arguing you can be working class and a millionaire property developer. But at the same time, you know, heavily indebted graduates who are probably, you know, never going to own a house as long as they live and might be stuck in temporary, precarious and low paid white collar employment for, you know, decades are, you know, presented as middle class and elitist because they live in London or another metropolitan centre and they know what an avocado is. And the Conservatives have really been able, I think, to capitalise on that decoupling of class identity from economic base. They've been able to play that game very well. And I think that that's the heart of identity politics and even the heart of, you know, so-called culture wars, is how does political conflict play out on a terrain of values, of norms, of ideas, in a way which has a relationship to what's going on, you know, with the economic base, but certainly isn't reducible to it and can sometimes have a really contradictory relationship to it. The other thing is of course, demographics. Demographics and how it relates to electoral geography. The Conservatives do well in constituencies where there's an older electorate, where you've got constituencies which have been affected by an exodus of the young. They do very well amongst homeowners, amongst those red wall seats. And they do, you know, worse in metropolitan centres. We've got more BAME voters and also where you've got more young voters as well. That BAME vote is not homogenous. There are fault lines emerging within it. And I think that a smart politician, whether that's someone like Rishi Sunak, whether that's someone like Priti Patel, I think might be able to, you know, exacerbate those fault lines and, you know, peel off sections of, in particular, the South Asian community, bits of the South Asian community whose, you know, instincts are kind of petty bourgeois, and also aspects of it which is defined by antipathy towards, you know, Bangladeshi, Pakistani, Muslim communities. There's also a kind of thread of anti-blackness in there as well, and appealing to a kind of model minority, get up and go kind of thing. I think that perhaps, you know, Sunak, maybe Patel, but I think that she maybe lacks some of the sophistication, would be able to exacerbate those fault lines. So I think that the left often appeals to demographics and we go, okay, look, the demographics are changing. Conservative voters are aging out of the electorate. You've got rising diversity. At some point, it's going to be really good for a Labour government. Maybe. You've still got the problem of Labour having captured, oh, is that Keir or is that Rickman?
Yeah, that's Rickman. I just noticed me and Peter were having a cut off, but my cat's decided to start attacking the camera, which is quite a critical.
Yeah, your cat just really doesn't rate my read of like demographic change in British politics. Just like, this is nonsense. is that the left looks at demographics and goes, right, that's where our hope is. But there's still, I think, big trouble for Labour dealing with the fact that it's captured the city, but it doesn't have a foothold in the hinterlands anymore. And that there isn't, you know, first past the post is punishing if you don't have an effective geographic spread of your voters, which the Conservative Party still has. So that's my take on the structural issues shaping voting behaviour, both for the Labour and the Conservative Party.
So, Pete, before I ask the last question, can I just see, can we just focus in on the cat first? We'll have a little cat off. What's come on? Introduce this is a celebrity socialist cat. This is Rickman. Who are we talking to here?
This is Orlando, the marmalade cat.
Hello, Orlando.
Orlando was so interested in what Ash had to say that he came and sat on my lap and listened.
So is Rickman. But you are a cat whisperer with your politics. Yeah.
You know what? I miss having a cat so much. I used to have this cat who my mum got because my mom is a social worker. She works in child protection and she was working with a client who had too many cats and was like, do you want a cat? Mom was like, sure.
Orlando, I want to want you to meet Rickman.
Yeah, come on, say hello Rickman, say hello to Orlando. Hello. Finally, just to begin where we started, basically. So we've got Allegra Stratton now, who's going to be the spokesperson. She's going to appear in these big daily press conferences. And she was at the BBC, then ITV, as a political journalist scrutinising the government. But in the past, Boris Johnson, a lot is in the past as well, David Cameron, George Osborne, Theresa May, most notably, I mean, Theresa May hired Robbie Gibb, who used to be in charge of BBC Westminster programming. What does that say about a democracy? The fact we have this revolving door between senior broadcast journalists who end up working for the very people they were supposed to be scrutinising.
Yeah, I think it's really upsetting. I mean, the great broadcasters when I was growing up, I'm quite old now, Robin Day, you know, or that was a wonderful a BBC political editor who with the Irish accent, who man of real passion and integrity. They weren't tempted to flip. And now what it is a manifestation of is the merger of the media and political class, which is, you can see in the fact that you have two newspaper columnists running Britain. And by the way, I hope that, I'm sad we've forgotten to talk about the fact that Michael Gove is the creature of Cummings, as well as Johnson having been the creature of Cummings.
Some say that Gove might actually be running the country now. What do you think about that?
I think that Gove gave us Cummings. Let's not forget that. And what it is you know, so Gove and Johnson, newspaper columnists, somehow managed to, with the aid of the right-wing press, unanimously took over the government of this country. And we now have this catastrophic situation where media and politics almost have become part of the same thing. Instead of media holding government to account, and just not even doing that, just telling the truth about what's going on, the senior figures, the political leaders, see themselves as a manifestation of the government of the day. I mean, I know that Johnson's done so badly in the last few months that they're trying to run for cover, but that was how Johnson emerged and how he governed in the early months. And so I do hope we can return to a situation where the political editor of a major newspaper or major broadcasting network doesn't see his or her future as some form of advisor or so forth inside the government. They got to remain. It's very important that they should remain independent.
I mean, just quickly, Ash, what are your thoughts on that in terms of, you know, because it's interesting in the era of Corbyn when you had entire newspapers acting as often very partisan defenders of the government. I'm not talking about columnists, we're talking about entire newspapers, not people who they express their opinions. Whilst anyone on the left, the very few largely freelance writers who supported the opposition leader were seen as somehow illegitimate.
I mean, look, I'm a partisan and I'm very open about that. And what I would like is just a bit more honesty from some of these journalists / propagandists. Because what's so insulting to all of our intelligence is that you've got journos who really just, I mean, leapt into that revolving door like there was, you know, dogs pursuing them. You've had Ross Kempsel, Allegra Stratton, you had Ellie Price, who was trying out for that Downing Street press officer role. Really too many to count, who are then also grotesquely offended that you might impugn the impartiality of their journalism before they got that job. To which my response is, well, if you were that good at your job and you were really holding politicians' feet to the fire, there's no way that they'd have offered it to you. You know, the relationship between journalists, in particular, you know, editors of broadcast programs, reporters, should be one of predator and prey, right? That's between journalists and politicians. Journalist is predator, politician is prey. And that applies as much, you know, to the left as anybody else. And I think that if you are a partisan, you need to be very open about where you are a partisan. It's easy enough to do if what you're writing is, you know, comment, analysis and opinion. But yeah, there is just this real insult to our intelligence that, you know, Allegra Stratton leaps into this role. And then you've got, you know, this is the industry class solidarity. You've got a whole bunch of people who still happen to be journalists, mostly, you know, because maybe their job application at number 10 wasn't successful, going, oh, how dare the intolerant left, you know, bully her and say that this was a reflection of her politics the whole time. You know, I was going to say, oh, it's grotesque or oh, it's disgusting. What it is just completely idiotic. And it's really insulting for how stupid it is. It's not even a particularly good magic trick. It's just having your wallet swiped.
Oh, and with that very powerful imagery, thank you very much for that, Ash, as I cross my legs, wincing slightly. What an absolute honour, both, well, not just Peter and Ash, but also Rickman and, sorry, how can I forget your iconic...
Orlando,
of course, Orlando.
Could I ask, who was Orlando named after? Was it the Virginia Woolf novel?
I got it recognised. It was an anomaly cat called Orlando. I think I hope I'm right, because I think it was my wife who named Orlando.
There's something really therapeutic about watching Peter Oborne stroke that mark cat. I kind of want to see it as a screensaver. Just it's very hypnotic, very relaxing to watch it.
Well, we have
times. Yeah. That's what we need.
Now we're having a reunion. We haven't seen each other for a couple of weeks, and so we're having a reunion.
And that's why I'm particularly appreciative. I mean, obviously, Ash. Obviously, I love you, Ash, and I'm always appreciative. But Peter has come back from essentially a war zone and had a bit of a nightmare journey coming back and made it just in time. So thank you, both of you, very much. I haven't finished with you, viewer, by the way. Stay with me just for a few more minutes before, just as we let it go. But if you're able to do so, give them a round of applause, because I think they were an absolute dream team, a real class act. Thank you very much to Ash and Peter for huge amounts of wisdom, huge amounts of insight, a very dynamic duo.
Thank you very much. It was a great pleasure coming on. Thank you very much, Owen.
It was a huge, huge honour. So before I go, everyone, firstly, come on, that was good. That was full of insight. I think a bit, they've never spoke before. They've never been on air before. So I think, you know, if you're a TV booker, consider the Ash and Peter show. Before we go, just a couple of things. Firstly, give this channel a bit of a subscribe, because we've got some very interesting content coming up. But don't just subscribe. Press the bell. Bear with me. When you subscribe to a channel, you can press the bell, which gives you notifications when video comes out. So you know when this is going to happen. This is going to happen every Sunday. Next week, so far lined up, the former Blair advisor, John McTurnan, plus a lefty. So I think we'll have, I think it'll be quite an energetic discussion, but stay tuned for that one. I've got a couple of great interviews coming up, ranging from John McDonnell to Piers Morgan. It is going to be eclectic, as I promised. But also, we've got some videos which we've been spending a bit of time on. If you haven't, this is up to you. And if you've got a bit of spare cash, these are difficult times. But I'm hiring a producer, as well as working with a videographer on union wages. So if you want to give any money, whatever you've got, to Patreon/OwenJones84, so we can expand this channel, have these really thoughtful but interesting discussions, challenging the mantras that were otherwise fed, that would be appreciated, but no pressure. But above all else, I will see you next time, next Sunday, 7 o'clock, with it might be quite an explosive discussion, but it will be thoughtful, because that's what we're trying to aim for on this channel. But check out the interviews and the videos we've got lined up next week. It's been a massive honor, and I hope you're all well. Lots of love, and I'll see you very soon.